So as Jeff mentioned, I'm Ted Panton. I'm with GGLO. I'm really just coming before you today as a practitioner. I'm kind of thought of a lot of different ways to present this information, you know, sort of how to conceptualize it or how to kind of walk you through the story. But I think the best way to think of this is just like you came into my office, I'm going to show you a couple projects that I have on my desk and just kind of show you how we got to where we got and get the lessons learned. I'd also just want to really give a shout out to the Seagate presentation. I thought that was an extremely thorough evaluation of the issues at hand, and just also to double down on the need for this stuff to be discussed at a very early phase in the project, the life of a project. And sort of relative to that, in this sort of collage you see up here, these are the four sites I'm going to talk to you about. And each one of them has a little bit different story in terms of its site constraints, but this is how these typically come to us when we're doing density, we're doing housing. We probably do 10 site studies for every actual real project in our office. So in many cases, the client has not even closed on the property that's in question. So we're going and making a lot of assumptions before they even get across the finish line in the derby for acquiring commercial real estate. And the time to discuss that is really even then as a site opportunity. You've probably seen these transects before, but we kind of tweak this a little bit for kind of a housing standpoint. There's this really great thing with CLT where, you know, we're really tapping into the carbon story or the manufacturing story, the kind of red state, blue state issues. But when it gets to housing, we like to think that we're creating these immersive environments. And to date, that has not really been an opportunity for us. And I think there's a real simple reason for that is things have to be 1 hour construction, typically in our two occupancies. But with mass timber, because we're 1 hour without doing anything else to it, we're good to go. We're good to create these sort of immersive environments for people to use and enjoy. And we're then able to enliven and enrich our cities with this. And to follow Jeff's point earlier, I think there is a pretty big story too about applying market responsive solutions into the social equity story. And if there aren't market responsive opportunities, and it doesn't really matter who you are, if you're a housing authority, if you're an affordable housing provider, private nonprofit of any kind, I think the market responsiveness of any solution is going to really be the go, no-go for that. And of course the goal, as Jeff mentioned earlier, we're really looking at equity, attainability, and livability as really the goals in creating a new paradigm for housing types. In terms of typologies, and the Seagate folks talked about this a bit, and I'm going to drill down into it a little bit deeper. There is already, under our current codes, a lot of support for doing wood projects, and mass timber is just part of that wood story. So if you look, just go back one here, at kind of an FAR of 1.25 or even 1.5, you get sort of ground-related building types that are housing types that are appropriate for some neighborhoods. You go to an FAR of 2 and you might get flats. You might get like 3 or 4 stories of flats. And that, of course, can all be wood. And in Seattle and Oregon and a few other places, you're allowed to go 5 stories with wood entirely and get up to an FAR of probably 3.25 or even a little bit more just with 5 floors of wood. Then as you transition to concrete and wood hybrid systems, you're taking another step up in density. So there's kind of a concrete base, if you will, a podium with wood on top. And as you build that, in our market in Seattle, you're actually allowed to do a 70-foot building, which is a 5/2, which is pretty pretty intensive in terms of FAR, getting almost up to 5. And now we're even allowed to do triple podiums, although really from a cost standpoint, there haven't been a lot of takers with a triple podium project. And so right now, one of the little policy takeaways is that the city's looking maybe 6/2 as an alternate to doing 5/3, because really you can see the math's probably not going to work out. I mean, there's the additional floor that you got to get that 8th floor is unfortunately made out of concrete and not out of wood. So then far in the distant future too, I mean, there's the potential for wood type 1B buildings. Right now they would be made out of steel or concrete, of course. So that's, I'm just kind of putting that out there for reference. The thing about that is I think in terms of FAR, you're just getting a little bit more out of that. You're not getting, you know, a significant increase in density for the dollars involved. So I think, at least right now as it stands, a lot of these other types that you see here are a lot more applicable to a given site opportunity. And so that's kind of a little background on that. I presented this last year. It's just a really a hybrid system, as others have done as well. As I mentioned, I like to kind of think of it at the very outset, though, as really kind of growing the building from the inside out using this system and having it being an informer of our design potential for projects. And kind of behind that is that, you know, if you look at all CLT systems, I think number one, they're kind of expensive, but number two, they're also rather impermeable. A lot of the support spaces that we need, or a lot of the support functions like mechanical, electrical, plumbing especially, have a little bit of a challenge working their way through this without a lot of coordination. Of course, our housing is also delivered with bidder design kind of paradigm, so a lot of the bidder community isn't involved until a good deal later on in the process. And so that's why we've kind of held on a little bit to the open framing in these solutions. And so these cavities, whether they're wall cavities or floor cavities, are really great places actually for all of these wiring, plumbing, gravity systems, as we'll see as we get through. So the thesis really was to merge these two together and hopefully in a very intentional way, where there's really kind of a each superstructure system is doing what it's really meant to be doing and make it very purposeful. And we started at the sort of module, the unit module, and worked our way outwards and started to build the sort of density really with this sort of wet and dry system where, as you can see in this section and some of these other views, the plumbing, the kitchen spaces, all of that is really set back into where open framing is, and the living space is really the daylight zone where you want a lot of glazing and where people are going to be spending most of their time is also sort of out next to the glazing in the frontage. You can see that's all done in CLT. So a quick takeaways in terms of managing costs. There's no real surprises here, but I just wanted to review them quickly. Replacing concrete and steel components wherever possible. In a few of these case studies I'm going to show you, we were able to do that, and that's a cost win. Potential for lower on-site costs, as was discussed earlier. I think this is particularly true in California, and the case study we have from California, I'm going to talk a little bit about that. Hopefully our numbers are going to work out there. Providing these immersive biophilic interiors, I think that's kind of the right thing to do, and I think a lot of affordable housing providers have this desire as well. We've responded to a few RFPs where this has been a priority from a given provider, so it's great to see that. Then lastly, and I think most importantly, is increasing what I call your vertical yield. And that's a term that I kind of invented, or I think I did. And what that means, vertical yield, developers talk about horizontal yield a lot because that's really important. You know, what are you getting out of a certain site? What you get out of a site and the horizontal yield is really directly associated with the value of the land. And that's why you see so much competition in these urban areas for these great commercial sites. The vertical yield that you get even just in a little building like this, this is a 4 to 5 story building that we're gonna talk about here in a moment. We were able to squeak in that extra floor, that number two floor, that we would not have otherwise in a 40 foot zone. So you can imagine if you went to a 70 or an even 85 foot zone, those savings in terms of the vertical clearances that you get with CLT are sort of compounded at that level. So, it's roughly about 6 inches per floor when you go from an 11 7/8 kind of conventional rough framed conventional floor to a CLT panel when you drop it in as a 5-ply. So that's a pretty big bonus. So the case studies, just want to like back up for a moment. All these include teams. I want to give a shout out to KLH, KPFF, and the client who's Cadence Real Estate, we jumped in late 2016, and unfortunately, that's where my numbers came from, late 2016. We know there's been a lot of inflation. Probably the last 4 months, there's been 10% inflation in the Seattle area for construction costs. So my numbers are going to be kind of, I'm going to breeze those pretty quickly. But at any rate, we just looked at this site and found we got the extra floor. A few of the other things I wanted to throw in the mix is, when you're talking at the early outset, when we looked at this as non-elevated buildings and non-parked buildings, and so there's some cost savings associated with that. And so it kind of puts everybody in the mood. It's like, oh, well, maybe we could do this. You know, we don't have an elevator. We didn't spend X amount on an elevator. We didn't spend X amount on parking, which produces no revenue, and or at least it doesn't directly relative to tenants. So that was kind of the impetus, is like, wow, okay, we think we can make this work with these five-story buildings that are just going to sit on the ground. In terms of kind of a section, what you see here is there's a lobby space that's kind of getting back to some of the dissimilar loads we were talking about earlier. This earlier rendering, we were thinking of running the span direction a little differently than we are now, so there's been a few tweaks since here, since this time. But the basic premise is that really, again, you see the living spaces are out, they're open. As part of the planning for this building, I was going to mention, we also looked at creating two separate buildings so that every unit has an outside corner, and that made mass timber even more of an obvious solution because you're able to create this sort of wafer-thin edge condition for all of those units and sort of glaze those edges and make it that much more livable. By creating two buildings, we're also able to sell this through the entitlement process and create a decent open space between, or a meaningful open space between, that we felt like was a good message for the community and good message for those that were reviewing our project. Here you can see kind of blowing the sides open and just looking at the system itself. Four units per floor. We only have one stair in each one of these buildings. We're right at the threshold of that. That was another cost savings that gave this roughly an 86% efficiency, almost that of what you would see in a really good larger building. So we were pleased with the results of that in terms of efficiency. But what I did want to share is the plumbing, the gravity systems, which you see going through here, always a problem on projects, always an 11th hour crisis. You know, we don't get plumbing information until it's way too late usually. And so much of my career has been sort of had anxiety-ridden moments of gravity systems that didn't quite work out the way we thought, and so there needs to be some changes, and there tends to be a lot of, like, everybody in a bad mood at that point. So we keep it simple. We're going to keep that center portion where all those bathrooms and kitchen spaces are open, and that's how it works. And then living spaces, of course, we're going to go ahead and transition to that visible CLT lid. What we got from KLH in terms of pricing at the outset included a finish on this, which was pretty nice, and so that allowed this to kind of happen as well. Just some more shots of the interior spaces that are kind of a result of this, kind of how it stacks up. And there you get a view of the corners. You know, so every unit would have an open corner like this. So then, again, just going to go through the budget really quickly. I mean, the base open framing we figured was like $238. If we add all this together, we felt like we were about 338-ish in these 2016 numbers, really. So about $100,000 difference from one to the next, you know, in terms of introducing this. But there was also the fact that we were able to get out of a transfer condition, which was kind of nice. And then getting back to the vertical yield story, which I will in a moment, I'll just go to that. We were able to get a fifth floor, so it allowed us to get two additional units, which we wouldn't have got otherwise, so that's kind of like another thing to kind of toss into the equation. The other thing to toss into the equation is, as I mentioned earlier, the savings in concrete and steel. If you can impact those other numbers, then the presence of the bigger wood number makes a lot more sense. Just gonna keep going here. So the next example is the same client and really the same team, and we also worked with Gurdon, who is a modular provider. They were interested in doing this as a modular project, and so we thought, wouldn't it be cool to like take what we learned on the other project in CLT and then kind of put it into the stream of modular technology? And so that's what we did. There's a few ominous things that you see in this shot. One is the overhead utilities, which will come into play a little bit later on, and the fact that you're on a pretty steeply sloping site with some issues and heavy tie-in storm and other things of that nature. But we kind of bought into this, I think, from an affordable housing standpoint. We've tried modular. A lot of times your program is bigger, you know, maybe two bedrooms and one bedrooms, family size units, and so modular might not be the best fit for that. But same time, there's a lot of, I think really, for lack of a better word, SRO type affordable housing typologies that might benefit from this, where you're able to take advantage of all modular offers. We 3D printed each one of these units and just to kind of make sure it all worked and fit it on the truck like it's supposed to. We did all of the little saw boxing studies when we put all this together and kind of came up with what you see here. The impetus for using mass timber is really exacerbated, or it's exaggerated with modular, because modular already has almost a 27-inch floor system, and that makes it a killer. It's kind of the opposite of CLT in a lot of ways. If you look at CLT and conventional framing and then modular has the thickest floors, and those thick floors are not going to help you with your vertical yield. And that vertical yield is important, like we know. So we were able to get that down to 21 inches, which is, I think, serviceable, you know, by introducing CLT into that to the lid of this modular unit. But even still, there were some other issues that conspired against this. I think the 300-ton crane that's needed, the street shutdown, street closure, you know, all those have pretty big impacts. And on a tight site, the overhead utilities did as well, you know, just sort of decommissioning all that to bring in all the heavy equipment to place these modules. So right now, the project is still a go, but we're working a bit away from it being modular and just being sort of a conventional hybrid project like we were looking at the other ones. The third example, we're going to go down into the Bay Area here. This is India Basin, for those who are familiar with it. And this is part of a master plan that Build is doing there. They hired Gail a couple years ago to do the master plan, which is a really wonderful master plan. And as you can see here, there are some towers. These have since gone away for a few reasons. But really what you see here is about 1,600 units that could, by and large, be done with wood technology, which is a really great story. What we did with them, they're at the very early phases of getting approvals for this, but we got a site and sort of ran it through the gears, and so we'll show you what we did there. There's kind of a color version of it. I believe Lennar is doing a very large master plan out to the southeast of here as well, in the same Hunters Point area. At any rate, in this one little pad, the issue was having retail at the base, or sort of a market hall, if you will. We were looking at doing a bit of a farmer's market, which you see in the sheds that are in the foreground or at the base of this, sort of metaphorically bringing those over and engaging the building, creating a base that was really like a farmer's market that the rest of the building sat on. And of course, that big high bay space is, you know, going to be an issue in terms of structure as far as, you know, wanting to solve that. So as we got into it, we started looking at everything stacked up. As we understand it, one of the kind of the deal here was that, you know, in the Bay Area and specifically in San Francisco, rough framing costs are quite high, and so we found that we were actually pretty comparable. And this particular client was considering doing the whole floor system in this, you know, basically in mass timber, just given the lower on-site labor. And on-site labor is a huge deal there. I'll get into that a bit more in the takeaways, but you know, having a reduction in on-site labor without going all the way to modular, which is a real political lightning rod there, was an interesting step for us. Here you see the kind of the housing sitting above that, excuse me, high bay space, and kind of the relationship that we were excited about this because we could do some sort of point load supported elements here with the CLT serving as a span between that. And but by and large, these point load supports are about 24 feet apart, which feels pretty manageable. Just keep going here. The last site is pretty close to these other ones, going back to Seattle, and it also has a bit of the same story as far as mixing things up. In this case, we're allowed actually to have four floors and maybe even a fifth floor, kind of from an affordable housing standpoint. Seattle's in the midst of actually amending the zone we're in so that we might get a whole nother floor out of this. So this might actually end up being a complete five-story building with a high bay first floor space. We had, again, like retail on the first floor, but then we also looked at doing walk-up units, which I'll zoom into here, walk-up units fronting the street. And the interesting sort of story that we were creating there is that we wanted those units to have mezzanines. Now, of course, if you do a mezzanine, number one, it doesn't count as a story, which is nice in terms of calculating the number of stories you're allowed. But the other thing is the acoustic issues of separating one unit from the next are actually a lot less. So we could look at maybe even doing this very nominal mezzanine within this loft unit that has minimal you know, sort of need to address the acoustic concerns that it normally would have. And so we ended up with a module, something like this, where maybe even you do the guardrails for this mezzanine loft out of CLT. Maybe that's like a three-ply, and you do a little bit of that. And I will just wrap it up here because I know we're running a little bit late. The last thing I wanted to talk about was incentives. Just quickly, for affordable housing, incentives are kind of like, why would the city want to do this versus not do it and approve you? Seeking out expedited permit review, if any of you have connections with your agencies, that would be a great one to say, yeah, we want to do this. We would really love your help. Prioritizing design guidelines and other controlling documents, that's going to take time, but kind of getting it in that stream. And lastly, ironically, seeking a little relief from energy compliance, we actually had some issues in our Cadence 21 project because the energy code has taken so long to resolve for us in that project, which is ironic because really it's mass timber, which has this great LCA story, and we're all kind of hung up on the EU EUIs that were needed for energy compliance. And with that, I'm going to hand it over, and thank you very much.